Hi everyone. So today we are going to see about the brake test on three-phase slip ring induction motor. So already we have seen the theoretical concept of slip ring induction motor in our class hours. So today we are going to analyze the performance of three-phase slip ring induction motor in our laboratory. So before going for the experimental procedure, we can recall some points on induction motors. So nearly 80% of the mechanical power required by the industries are satisfied by the induction motors. So induction motors are simple in construction, and they are having very good operating characteristics. They are very cheaper. Good speed regulation can be achieved by employing external resistance in case of slip ring induction motors. So they are broadly classified into two types based on their rotor construction. First one, squirrel cage induction motor. Second one, slip ring or wound rotor machine. So in case of squirrel cage induction motor, they are having rotor bars short circuited by the end ring. But in case of slip ring induction motor, they are having rotor winding similar to that of stator winding, and they are wound for same number of poles as that of stator. So when come to the principal operation of induction motor, so whenever we are giving supply to the stator winding, it can able to induce EMF. So this EMF can able to circulate current over the stator, which in turn produce flux called as stator flux. So the stator flux can react with the rotor, and the rotor EMF will produce. So already we are having a short circuit path in rotor in both the squirrel cage as well as slip ring. In case of squirrel cage, because of end ring arrangement, in case of slip ring induction motor, we are having external resistance connected to the rotor, and it forms closed path. So because of that, rotor EMF can able to circulate rotor current, so which in turn produces rotor flux. So already we are having stator flux, now rotor flux also there. The two flux will interact each other, and there exists a torque. So because of the torque, induction motor will rotate. So this is the principal concept behind the operation of induction motor. So once again, come to slip ring induction motor. As I told, here they are having rotor winding similar to that of stator winding. You can see the diagram over here. Okay, so they are laminated and slotted. So windings are kept over the slot. So slip rings are continuously connected to the permanently connected to the rotor winding, and the slip rings are mounted over the common shaft. So the external resistance are connected to the rotor circuit through the slip ring and brush assembly. So these are the basic information about slip ring induction motor. So come to, so now we can see the purpose of conducting this experiment. So analyze the performance of a given three-phase slip ring induction motor by conducting the load test. So to determine the performance of the given machine by doing the load test. So here we can say during the no load test, what are all the measured values? For example, input voltage, input current, input power W1 and W2, and rotor speed, and spring balance readings like S1 and S2. So these are the measured values. From the measured values, what are all the calculated values? For example, output power, efficiency, slip, and also power factor. So similarly, when you are applying some load, for example at maximum load, what are all the electrical parameters? From the measured values, what is the obtained or calculated values with respect to output power and also efficiency? So from these values, we can able to determine the performance of the given machine. So here, apparatus required for conducting this experiment. We require 1 voltmeter, that should be in the range of 0 to 600 volt moving ion. 1 ammeter, it should be in the range of 0 to 10 ampere. Since in our laboratory we are having the slip ring induction motor, current rating of 7.5 ampere. So we can use the ammeter rating for 0 to 10 ampere moving ion. So we require 2 wattmeter for the measurement of three-phase power. That should be in the range of 600 volt to 10 ampere, 0 to power factor. 1 tachometer for the measurement of rotor speed, and required connecting wires. Here you can see the circuit diagram for our experiment. You try to ignore the rating given here, because the circuit was taken from the internet source. The rating what I have talked in the apparatus required, that will be the rating of our machine as well as machine device. These data I have taken from the circuit I have taken from the internet source. So just to see the circuit diagram, ignore the data given for the measuring device as well as the machine, as well as fuse. So as per the protocol, we are having R, Y, B phases for supplying the power to the machine. We are having DPSD as MCB, and we are having fuse based on the depending upon the current rating of the machine. We have to fix the fuse rating. Fuse is very important for the production of machine. And here voltmeter is connected between R phase and Y phase, so it can be used for the measurement of R Y voltage. Phase voltage, R Y phase, and current. Current can be measured with the help of ammeter. Here ammeter is placed over the Y phase, and we are having two wattmeters placed over R phase and B phase, and Y phase kept as a common for the measurement of three phase power. Here we are having a rotor resistance starter. So here the rotor resistance are connected to the rotor winding through the slip ring and brush assembly. So for the stator, directly we are receiving power from the wattmeter. So here sometimes we can use a DOA starter for deriving the power for the stator winding of slip ring induction motor. So here we can see the brake drum arrangement, loading arrangement. So depends upon the load we are applying to the machine, the value of the spring balance value S1 and S2 will change proportionally to the load we are applying for the machine. And I think I have covered everything. So we are having supply phases, TPSD switch, fuses, voltmeter, one voltmeter and one ammeter for the measurement of phase voltage and line current, and two wattmeter for the measurement of three phase power. Rotor resistance, this is very, very important. Initially, it should be connected at maximum ohmic value. So in order to reduce the starting current, I think we know the purpose of using starter in a machine. So initially, it should be in maximum position while turning on the machine. Slowly, we have to reduce the resistance by changing the knob or tab. Once the complete knob has been reduced, the machine will achieve the maximum speed. So initially, it is used for reducing starting current, and we can able to get maximum torque in that condition. So I think I have explained the complete circuit diagram. We'll go for next slide. So procedure. So we have to make connection as per the given circuit diagram in the previous slide. And initially, we have to close the TPSD switch, and then we have to turn on the supply for stator. And parallelly, we have to turn on the rotor resistance starter. Then only the circuit will get close, so that the machine will run. And we have to measure the readings for no load, and respectively, we have to do the same for different loading conditions. And one thing we have to make a note during initial condition, during the no load condition, one wattmeter definitely will show negative deflection because of very low power factor. So we know the formula for power derived from each wattmeter. For example, you can take W1, the formula, the power derived from wattmeter 1 can be root 3 VLIL cos 30 plus 5. Similarly, if it is 30 plus 5, formula for power derived from second wattmeter will be root 3 VLIL 30 minus 5. In case if the value of 5 exceeds 60 degree, automatically we can cos 5 will be more than 90, we will get the negative value. So for that, we have to interchange the terminals M and L. So it will occur because since we are using two wattmeter for the measurement of three phase power, that too for the machine we are using. So it is induction machine, definitely power factor will be very, very low during no load conditions. That time we have to interchange the terminal M and L. So here in our laboratory we are having that wattmeter that has a changeover switch. That time if we are getting negative deflection, we can adjust the changeover switch, we can adjust and we can turn on, turn off the changeover switch accordingly. The M and L terminal will interchange. So once during the next set of readings, if it is going negative deflection, which means actually it is going forward, positive direction, that time once again we can change the position of changeover switch. And the procedure can be repeated till the rated current of the motor is achieved. So finally, once all the data, for example, input current, input voltage, input power using W1, W2, speed, spring balance reading, everything we are measuring for all set of reading, and the procedure has been wind up after the full load current has been given for the machine by applying maximum load. So here at final we have to unload. Before going to turn off the machine, we have to unload the setup in order to protect the machine, and the TPSD should be opened and after the rotor resistance starter has been turned off. So these conditions you have to keep in our mind very carefully. Before unloading, we should not turn off the machine. How step by step we have increased the load. Similarly, we have to make our machine completely unloaded. Then we have to come for turning off or opening the TBST as well as rotor resistance starter to turn off. And these are the formulas we are using for obtaining some data like output power, efficiency, torque, power factor, and slip. You can see the input power is equal to sum of power taken from wattmeter 1 and wattmeter 2, W1 plus W2, and output power 2 pi and T by 60. Here, N is nothing but rotor speed, T is nothing but torque bend, and torque is proportional to 9.81 into R into S1 minus S2. Here, R is nothing but radius of brake drum. So, radius of brake drum we can able to calculate from the circumference of the brake drum, which is equal to 2 pi R, and from here we can calculate the value of R and S1 minus S2, spring balance value. Initially during no load condition, both the value will be zero, but when you are applying load, S1 and S2, we can obtain the value for S1 and S2. So proportionally we can get a torque value, and efficiency, output power by input power, input measured, output calculated, so we can get efficiency. So power factor we know cos phi. So phi can be determined from tan phi, which is root 3. W1 minus W2 by W1 plus W2. So here, from this formula, we can obtain the value for phi. So this phi can be substituted over cos phi, and we can get the power factor for every reading. So whenever the load has been increased, proportionally change in W1 and W2 will be there. Proportionally phi will change. So accordingly, we can get a different power factor value for each set of reading. So this for input, and finally slip. So synchronous speed minus rotor speed by synchronous speed, if it is percentage, we can multiply by 100, so that we can get a slip, percentage slip we can get. These are the formulas used for obtaining the respective values. So this is a tabulation. Here we are having voltage measurement, current measurement, speed, wattmeter reading, and we are having W1 and W2, two wattmeter reading will be there because of previous power, and here observed and actual. Because since we are having a different set of scale in ammeter, voltmeter as well as wattmeter, for choosing the specific scale, for example 300 voltage range, 600 voltage range, 900 voltage, different range we can able to measure in wattmeter as well as voltmeter. So if we are choosing specific voltage, specific current, for that multiplication factor will be there, that we have to consider. So absorbed value, what you are measuring from meter, and proportional to the multiplication factor for the respective voltage and current, you are taking the lead from wattmeter, multiplication factor will be there, that we have to multiply for the actual set of value for both W1 and W2, that we can see while doing the experiment. And spring balance value, S1, S2, torque value, formula, you know, S1 minus S2 into R into 9.81, output power 2 pi into 60, power factor cos phi, tan phi, you know the formula, from there phi we can calculate, efficiency, output by input, slip, NS minus NR by N. So, up to here we have to measure, okay, during the experiment. So from here, torque, output power, power factor, efficiency, slip, we have to calculate using the formula we have seen in the previous slide. So this is the model graph for our experiment. So we are doing the graphical representation for output power versus efficiency, output power versus torque, output power versus speed, output power versus power factor, and output power versus slip. We can see the output power versus speed. So when initially when there is no load, the speed will be maximum, very close to synchronous speed. When you are applying load, automatically the speed will diminish, it will reduce, okay, gradually. So here we can see the value of slip. Initially the slip value will be very less, since we know NS minus NR by N. So initially NR will be very high because we are not applying any load. So NR will be high, so NS minus NR, the value will be very less. So it is very less during no load conditions. When you are applying load, when the output power increases, gradually slip value will increase because of reduction of rotor speed. Okay. So and we are having efficiency. So efficiency will gradually increase proportional to the output power. After some point, it will start reducing. Here, this point we can consider core loss is equal to copper loss. Again, you are increasing. Again, the output power is increasing. So, the copper loss will exceed the core loss. Efficiency will start reducing. So, efficiency of slip ring induction motor when comparing squirrel cage induction motor is very less because the rotor copper loss is very high in case of slip ring induction motor. Since we are having rotor winding, copper loss of slip ring induction motor is quite high when compared to squirrel cage induction motor. And so that's what efficiency is poor when comparing to squirrel cage induction motor. And only thing, high starting torque application can prefer slip ring induction motor. For the purpose only, it has been designed. And this is efficiency curve. And the slip I have already told. And this one speed. Here we can see power factor. Power factor gradually will increase proportional to the power. Because at no load, the power factor is very, very poor. That's what we are saying. The wattmeter also doing deflection in negative direction. So once the output power is increasing, possibly it will improve. The power factor will gradually will improve. We can see the torque. Torque also in ceiling. When the output power is zero, torque also will be zero because we know that S1 minus S2 will be zero because at no load there is no spring balance reading. So torque will be zero. So whenever you are applying the load, S1 S2 difference will be there. So proportionally torque will increase. Here in the y axis we can add one more parameter called load current, line current. So whenever whenever the torque increases, proportionally line current will increase because current depends upon the load. So whenever the load requires, torque will increase. So torque and line current are proportional, parallel, everything you can say. So here we can add one more axis also for current. So here also output power versus current also you can draw. So proportionally it will be equal to torque. Here initially zero when the output power is zero, gradually it will increase when the power increases. Here you can see only slip value will have some value during zero output power, and speed will be there when the output power is zero. So remaining all factor almost is zero when the output power is zero. See, these are the performance curve we are studying under slip ring induction motor. So now we are going to see the real time experimentation, and based on the values, obtained values, we can go for the calculation section. So thank you for watching this video.
Hi students. So now already we have seen the theory of slip ring induction motor in our class hours. So in continuation, today we are going to see about the real time experimentation on brake test on slip ring induction motor. So before going to do the experiment, we can see the nameplate of the machine, about the panel, and what are the measuring device we are using, what is the panel rating. So everything we can see before going for the experimentation. So initially you can see the nameplate of the machine, slip ring induction motor. So here you can see the stator rating, the machine rating is 5 HP, stator voltage is 415 voltage, and current rating is 7.5 ampere, speed up to the range of 1440 rpm. So here you can see the rotor ratings, voltage is same, similar like of stator, 415 voltage, and the current rating is 11 ampere. Now you can come for the panel. So this one will be the miniature circuit breaker acting as a TPST. So this one fuse arrangement for three phases, and here you can see the phase indications RYB. And come to here, so this is the phase supply RYB and neutral. Here you can see some more terminals like L1, L4, L2, L5, L3, L6 and neutral, which indicates direct online starter. Here we are supplying the power to the stator of slip ring induction motor through DOL starter. Since it is 5 HP machine, we can prefer DOL starter. So we can see some more terminal here, D, E, F. So this is projected from our rotor resistance starter. Okay, since it is slip ring induction motor, we have talked much thing about rotor resistance starter. We have to start the machine with the help of rotor resistance starter. So what is the purpose of rotor resistance starter? So already we know the concept of starter, why we are using starter for a machine. So without starter, we are starting a machine, what will happen to the machine? So those things we know, but for slip ring motor in special, we are using rotor resistance starter to limit the starting current. That already we have seen the theory. So this is the terminal taken from rotor resistance starter, DEF, and here we have RYB terminal, that is projected from stator of slip ring induction motor. and the last one we can see DEF, that is a rotor winding of slip ring induction motor. So these are the panel board terminals, fuse, MCB, phase indications, everything we have seen in the panel. And now we can see about the machine rating in the back. Here we are having the terminals of stator and rotor winding. Two set of terminal, one is for stator RYB and another one is for rotor DEF, as the projection we have seen in the panel as RYB and DEF. So when come to here, so here we can see the loading arrangement. Okay, so this one spring balance setup S1 and S2. So whenever we are applying load from here, we can see the change in the spring balance reading. So here through the belt we are giving pressure to the brake drum arrangement. Automatically we can able to see the slip ring readings. From the spring balance reading, we can able to calculate the torque of a machine. So this one brake drum arrangement, so this one spring balance arrangement. So from here we can load the machine. So now I am going to explain about the measuring instruments, devices we are using for our experiment. So this one, as I already explained in Zoom class, we are having one voltmeter, one ammeter and two wattmeters for the measurement of three-phase power. This one voltmeter, so since we are measuring three-phase voltage, so here it should be in the range of 0 to 600. Okay, here you can see the terminal, a common point, 300 volt terminal and the 600 volt terminal. As I told, we are measuring three phase voltage, so here we are preferring the terminal common and 600. Here also you can see the scale. Scale 1 is up to 300 voltage, scale 2 is up to 600 voltage, here we are taking up to 600 voltage. So second one, ammeter, as already we have seen in the nameplate, we are having the current range up to 7.5 ampere, so we have taken the ammeter reading up to 10 ampere. Here you can see the terminal, common point 10 ampere and 5 ampere. So here we are taking the terminals between common and 10 ampere. And here you can see the scale. Scale 1 indicates up to 10 ampere and scale 2 for 5 ampere. Here we are choosing the scale between common point and 10 ampere, since our rating is less than 10 ampere. And third one, wattmeter. So here we can see the terminals, line, main and common point. And also here we are having voltage terminals, as like our voltmeter, 600 and 300. As I told while explaining about voltmeter, here we are measuring up to three-phase voltage we are measuring. So we can choose the voltage terminal for 600 voltage. And here some more terminals you can see here, E2, E1, B1, B2. I will explain why we are using E2, E1 and B1, B2 here in this wattmeter. So here are some nameplate given for the wattmeter. So when you are connecting the terminal B1 and B2, we can able to measure the current rating up to 10 ampere. So when you are connecting the terminal B1, E2 and E1, B2, we can measure the current up to 20 ampere in this wattmeter. So whenever you are preferring 10 ampere and 300 voltage, multiplication factor for this wattmeter is 1. So whenever you are preferring 10 ampere and 600 voltage, the multiplication factor for this wattmeter is 2. So see, similarly, if you are preferring 20 ampere and 300 voltage, multiplication factor is 2. And if you are preferring 20 ampere and 600 voltage, the multiplication factor is 4. So here we are measuring three phase voltage. So we are taking the terminal 600 voltage and we are measuring the current less than 10 ampere. So we are preferring 10 ampere. So multiplication factor is what? Multiplication factor for this wattmeter for our experiment is 2. Since 600 voltage and 10 ampere current. And another thing I want to show here, changeover switch is there. Generally for the measurement of three phase power, we are using two watt meter. So whenever we are using two watt meter for the measurement of power, particularly in machine, we will have a lagging power factor at no load. So at no load power factor will be very less. Whenever we are increasing the load, power factor will gradually increase. So since here in our experiment we are connecting the voltmeter between R and Y phase. So ammeter we are placing over any one phase, for example R phase I am keeping. So the power factor is measured between VRY and IR. So the power derived from each wattmeter, I can say, for example, power derived from wattmeter 1 is equal to root 3 VL IL cos 30 minus 5. Power derived from second wattmeter is root 3 VL IL cos 30 plus 5. So in case the power factor is exceeding 60 degree, automatically it will exceed cos 90. So once it is going beyond cos 90, automatically it will give some negative reading. That negative reading we can able to get from this wattmeter. So whenever we are getting negative reading, at that time we have to change the position of change over switch. For example, at the time if it is connected in forward, we have to change to reverse. So whenever you are changing to reverse, it can show the positive reading. So positive reading indicates it is not a positive reading, actually it is negative. By changing the change over switch, we are bringing to positive for the easy measurement. But while doing observation, we have to mention as negative. So whenever you are applying load, that time it will show the positive reading, which means, I mean, it will show the negative reading, which means positive. At the time, once again, you have to change over the switch so that we can able to measure the positive reading of the wattmeter. So from there, we can able to calculate the input power from two wattmeter W1 and W2. So here, second wattmeter also we are having. As like our previous wattmeter, we are having line, main and common and voltage terminal. Again, we are having change over switch. Here also they have mentioned about E2, E1, B1, B2. The same nameplate, whatever I have explained for wattmeter 1, same arrangement. So here we are preferring 600 volt and 10 ampere measurement. So the multiplication factor for this wattmeter is, so now I am going for panel board connection. First I am connecting three phase supply to the starters, DOL starter. So R2 L1, Y2 L2 and from B2 L3 of DOL starter, neutral terminal from supply to neutral of DOL starter. So now the main supply has been given for DOL starter. From DOL starter I am connecting, I am giving the supply to stator through the measuring instrument. So first I am connecting voltmeter between the first two phases R and Y. So now voltmeter has been connected between R and Y phase. So now I am connecting ammeter from R phase. So from ammeter we can make connection to wattmeter 1. Sorry, here so carefully we have to choose the terminal. As while explaining about the nameplate of all machine, I told voltmeter is for 0 to 600 and ammeter is for 0 to 10 ampere. First we have to connect for M, main. And we have to short MNC. We have to short MNC. And from the terminal L, we have to take the projection to R phase of stator winding. Since it is R phase, we can connect here. And now we can connect Y phase. Yeah, here I am shorting the V terminal of 2 watt meters. That should be 600 volt terminal. And this should be connected to Y phase of supply. Any other wires. So since it is a common point between R and B phase, since we are connecting the wattmeter, one in R phase, another in B phase, so Y will be in common. So directly we can connect Y phase to V terminal of wattmeter 1 and 2, and from here we can connect to y phase of stator winding. And for B phase, we can take from the DOI starter, and through wattmeter we can connect. Sir, one lengthy wire you can give, sir. The terminal of secondary side of DOI starter to the second wattmeter to the M terminal, and we should not forget MC. We have to start small wire, sir. Small. Watt meter one. I am shorting the terminal MC for watt meter two. You can see here I am shorting M and C. So from L terminal, we can connect to B phase of the stator. So nearly, so 90% of our connection over. Now we have to connect our rotor winding with rotor resistance starter. As I told, DEF indicates rotor winding terminal. So it should be connected to rotor resistance starter. And the projection of DEF has been made with the help of slip ring and brush arrangement. We know the theory. It is a rotating part of the slip ring induction motor. So through slip ring and brush assembly, we have taken the projection. So now I am connecting D terminal of rotor with D terminal of rotor resistance starter, E terminal of rotor with E terminal of rotor resistance starter. Finally, F terminal of rotor to F terminal of rotor resistance starter. Okay, so our connection arrangement and setup, everything is over. Now we will go for experimentation. So as I have kept the meter in sleeping position, so we will that error will not be there. While doing the observation of the reading, we can able to measure the exact reading when you are keeping in standing position. So some manual error may occur, so we can prevent this error by keeping our meters in sleeping position like this. So once again we'll check the connection. R phase has been given to R terminal of DOI starter, Y to Y, B to B, and neutral. From here we have connected across two phases. We have connected the voltmeter, and from R phase we have connected ammeter, and from here it is going for wattmeter 1. So in wattmeter 1, MC has been short circuited. So from L the wire has been taken for R phase of stator. Similarly, B phase of the DOI starter has been connected directly to M terminal of wattmeter. Here MC is short circuited. From L we have taken to B phase. So Y should be short circuited because Y phase is kept common for R and Y in case of wattmeter. So here directly we can see over here 600 of 2 wattmeters. It is given for Y phase of DOI starter, and from here the supply is given for Y phase of stator. Sorry. So while doing connection, we have to be very careful. So if you make loose connection, and we didn't observe over that while we running the machine, spark may occur. So be careful while doing connection. Okay, and finally we have connected rotor resistance starter with rotor winding, DEF with DEF. So now we are going to turn on the machine. So as I have told, this is a rotor resistance starter. We have to start the machine with the help of this starter. Initially the knob should be in position 1. So inside it is connected with the maximum ohmic value. So whenever it is having maximum ohmic value, it can prevent the maximum current that is flowing inside the circuit. In case you forget about the rotor as a starter, we can make short circuit of rotor. That time the machine can run as a squirrel cage induction motor. When you are connecting a rotor as a starter, the machine can run effectively with reduced starting current with maximum torque. Now we are going to turn on the machine. Now first I am turning on the MCB. So supply has been given for panel. Now I am going to start the rotor resistance starter. Now the machine is running. I have to hold the start switch. Gradually I have to reduce the resistance by increasing the tap from 0.122 223 and 324. So now I have kept the knob at 0.4, which means all the resistance has been removed from the circuit. Now the rotor has been short circuited. We are making this rotor resistance starter initially to limit the starting current. Once it has been picking up the speed by reducing the resistance, now the machine is running with short circuit condition of rotor. Okay, so now we can measure the no load parameters. Since the machine is running, we can measure the voltage reading, current reading, wattmeter reading, and also in the back seat also we can measure spring balance arrangement S1 and S2, and we can measure the speed also. So first we can see the voltage range. So as we are connecting the terminal between 0 and 600, we have to see the upper scale. So the voltage is approximately 200 plus. So we are getting up to 415 voltage input. So we can see the current over here. Okay. So no load current, we are not applying any load. Okay. So the current is around 3.2 ampere. And you can see the wattmeter reading. The wattmeter one, sir, it's not showing any. Sorry. So as I told while explaining about wattmeter, the first reading should be reflected in negative scale because of very low power factor. At that time we have to change the position of changeover switch so that we will get a positive reading. So the reading of wattmeter one is around 220. So that finally for observation we have to calculate with multiplication factor final reading we can take. And the wattmeter 2 we are getting around 410 watt. Okay, so these are the measurements taken from voltmeter, ammeter and two wattmeters. And now we can go for measuring loading arrangement and speed. So here spring balance reading we can see S1 and S2. Since we are not applying any load, S1 and S2 reads around zero value. Here you can see the speed. It is close to synchronous speed 1500. It is almost 14. It is fluctuating around 1495. So it is reading around 1496. So since we are not applying any load, speed will be close to synchronous speed. So whenever we are applying load, speed will gradually reduce. So the reading of S1 and S2 will be zero since we are not applying any load. So now we can go for applying some load. So in order to reduce the heat or temperature formed in the brake drum because of continuous rotation, so we have to pour some water in the brake drum so that it will create cooling. That the heat will be dissipated in the brake drum. So it is a must to practice when the machine is continuously running. Now gradually we are increasing the load. Okay, so as I told, our current rating of the machine is 7.5 ampere. Current rating of the machine is 7.5 ampere. We have to watch it. So now they are gradually increasing the load. We have to be keenly watching that the current rating of the machine is 7.5 ampere. It should not go beyond 7.5 ampere. So we are determining the performance of machine by applying different load. Now we are applying the load for 4 ampere. Next we can apply for a maximum load. So little bit you can increase the load. Yeah. 4. Yeah, 4. Okay. So now the current rating is 4. S1, S2. For the 4 ampere load we have given, we can see S1 and S2. Spring balance reading, S1, it is reading around 7, and S2 reads around 0.2. So from these two values we can able to analyze the torque of machine. At the speed we have to measure speed. So as I told, when we are applying some load, speed will reduce. So previously we have the speed, we have seen the speed 1497. Now it is around 1450. Nearly 40 RPM has been reduced because of applying load. 1450 previously we have seen at no load the machine is running around 1497. So after applying load of 4 ampere load, it is fluctuating around 1450. So gradually speed will reduce depending upon the load we are applying for the machine. So again we are applying load for the machine. Now we can see the maximum load we are applying for the machine. That time what is the performance of the machine we can calculate. You can increase, sir. Little bit you can increase. 6. Now the current rating of the machine is 6 ampere. It is driving 6 ampere. The voltage rating is same. And the current is measuring up to 6 ampere. The wattmeter reading gradually increasing, because since we are applying load, the input power is increasing. The wattmeter 1 and wattmeter 2 reading also gradually increasing. Now we can see the spring back. So now the speed is around 1405. And you can see the spring balance reading, it is 13 for S1 and is 1 for S2. So because we are applying maximum load, we are giving pressure through build, the humming sound. So now we are going to unload the machine. So before turning off the machine, we have to unload. So without unloading, we should not turn off the machine. It will harm the machine. Now we are unloading. So now the machine is running like no load condition. Now we can go for turning of the machine. So previously we have loaded the machine, same condition, no load condition, we have to bring to actual setup. So the continuously we have reduced the load. Now it is unloaded, the machine is running like a no load condition. Now I am going to turn off the rotor assist starter. Okay, now the running condition has been, now we have to bring the rotor assist starter to position 1. I am turning off TPST MCB, and one by one I am going to remove the connection. Initially we have to remove the supply. And as like we have made connection, we can remove everything. Actually we have did experiment on slipping induction motor. We have did a load test on slipping induction motor. We have taken 3 set of reading by applying 3 different load. We have measured voltage, current, wattmeter reading, spring balance reading, S1 and S2 and speed. So these are the measurement we have taken while doing load test. So from these values we can able to calculate the output power of machine, we can calculate the efficiency, we can calculate the power factor slip, and from those calculated data we can able to analyze the performance of slip ring induction motor.
So we are in our final part of our experimentation, calculation part. So already we have seen the formula used for this experiment. Once again we'll see that input power is the sum of wattmeter readings W1 plus W2, and output power is equal to 2 pi nt by 60, where n is the rotor speed, p is nothing but torque, which is equal to 9.81 into radius of brake drum into S1 minus S2. So S1 and S2 are the spring balance readings. So here we can calculate the radius of brake drum using the formula. Circumference is equal to 2 pi r. And efficiency is nothing but output power by input power. And the slip is synchronous speed minus rotor speed by synchronous speed into 100. And we can calculate the power factor cos phi. So phi can be determined using the formula tan inverse of root 3 W1 minus W2 by W1 plus W2. So now we are going for the tabulation. So these are the measured readings as well as the calculated output from the measured readings. First reading, input voltage 415 and input current 3.2, and it is no load values. Okay, so wattmeter one reads around 520. So here we didn't mention about actual and observed. Directly we have multiplied with multiplication factor, as I have explained about multiplication factor in the while doing the experiment. And directly we are observed over here. And the spring balance reading S1 and S2, since it is no load, I will get zero deflection in S1 and S2. And the speed we have measured up to 1480 during no load condition. And torque we have calculated from the measured values. It is zero for the no load. Since S1 and S2 are zero, so torque will be zero automatically. Output depends on torque, that also will be zero. And input power, the sum of W1 plus W2, it is equal to 280. And efficiency zero, since output power is zero, efficiency will read zero. And slip we have calculated around 1.3%, so from the synchronous speed and rotor speed. And finally cos phi is equal to 0.12 for the reading one. Then we have applied some load, and we have measured and calculated, and finally we have applied some maximum load. For that we have measured current voltage, wattmeter readings and spring balance and speed. So from there we have calculated the torque, output power, input power, efficiency, slip and power factor. So here we can see the model calculation. Synchronous speed can be calculated from 120 FBP, that is 1500 for this machine, since the frequency is 50 and the number of pole is equal to 4, it is 1500. And for no load calculation, rotor speed is 1480, and we are calculating torque for that. Okay, since S1 and S2, as I told, S1 and S2 are zero, torque will be zero, and proportionally output power will be zero. And here circumference, using circumference we have calculated the value of R. So while measuring the circumference, it is 96 centimeter. So we are converted into meter. So 96 into 10 power minus 2 by 2 pi, so that we got the radius of greater than is equal to 0.15 meter. And input power, W1 plus W2 for no load, it is around 280 watt. Efficiency, output by input, it is zero, since output power is zero. Efficiency will be zero. Slip is equal to ns minus nr by ns, so it is around 1.3%. So cos phi can be calculated using the tan phi formula, and finally it reads around 0.12 for no load. So this is the graph we are going to plot between output power versus efficiency, slip, power factor, speed and armature current. And we can also mark torque in the y-axis. So already we have seen the model graph in our previous class. So here it is also a model graph. It is not drawn for our measured and calculated reading. It is already did by our student. So from this graph we can able to get some idea, okay, how the characteristic waveform will be for different electrical parameters with respect to output power. So here we can see output power versus speed. So whenever we are increasing the output power, or whenever we are increasing the load, gradually the speed will decrease. As like we have seen in our model graph, the speed will decrease. Efficiency will gradually will increase after some point. It also will start fall down. Okay, so here we can say that core loss is equal to copper loss at this point. After that, again, when we are increasing, copper loss will exceed beyond the core loss. Again, the efficiency will start fall down. Okay, so here power factor, initially power factor will be zero. Sorry, power factor will be very poor, and gradually it will increase. Depends upon the load what we are applying, and armature current, no load current will be very minimum value. And gradually it will increase proportional to the load we are applying. Similarly, torque also we can mark over here. So whenever the output power is increasing, it is proportional to the torque. So torque also will increase. So torque is parallel to our load current. Both will linearly it will increase. So initially torque will be zero,
gradually it will increase, but for armature current initially because the machine requires no load current, so it is having some value. And efficiency, armature current, we have seen cost wave, we have seen slip also in sealing, the value will be very less since during no load condition the rotor will run at almost it is equal to synchronous speed, so it has a very minimum value. So once we are applying load, gradually the slip value will increase. So this is the model graph we have taken for our study purpose. So everything we have seen regarding the performance analysis of slip ring induction motor, and we came to a conclusion how the machine is performing. So based on the output power, efficiency, power factor and the slip value obtained by conducting the load test. So thank you for watching.